So, in the run-up to the Femme Fatale event at the Cedar Cultural Centre, which is coming up on Saturday, April 22nd, I'm excited to be joined by two of the women involved in said event. To begin with, welcome back, Lydia Liza.
Hi.
We go way back. Well, you,
we've been buds for a while.
We've been very good buds for a very long time.
Yeah.
And even in terms of Back to the City, you were the co-host of season two.
Yeah.
So yeah, welcome back. I'm very excited to have you here. The first time that you were on Back to the City, we talked about all kinds of things, including your collaborations with Christopher Michael Jensen, who is also just about to come back. He's got an LP he's just about to release.
That's awesome.
And with Dem Atlas too, kind of predating Baby It's Cold Outside. You had Who Loves the Snow. And, and Baby, It Was Cold Outside.
Yeah. So yeah, that was a really, really cold day. I think we were colder than Antarctica that day.
Wow. And what came of that low temperature was this brilliant collaboration between Bomba De Luz and Dem Atlas. You should check it out if you can find it online.
Yeah.
You highlighted at the time, well, you referred to two live experiences that had been especially important for you. One of them was the whole Welcome to MN tour, and just in general performing songs of Pangaea, because you were saying the experience of performing, and that's of course with Toki, right? The experience of performing songs off that record, which had to do with how painful it is to be on the earth, and also but had to do with unity as well, and the original, you know, there being one continent to begin with. You talked then in our first interview about the experience of performing that to people who really knew the significance of that and the impact. You must have had, with the success, of course, of your cover, a reworking of Baby It's Cold Outside. Was this something analogous with that experience? Would you say the idea of doing something which a massive amount of people were aware of the great significance of what you were doing?
Yeah, I mean, there were more people who really hated us for it, which was an experience.
But, yeah, it must have been.
It was really amazing to have people come out of the woodwork and say, like, this has given me the bravery, the courage to talk to my children about consent and people who were like sexual assault survivors and stuff. It was a lot of unity. I think a lot of people found power in it, which we didn't even know we were gonna bring that about. But
especially when you and Josiah Lemansky were at your work, just in, was it like 25 minutes putting these lyrics together? If I understand correctly, you thought, oh, what's a terrible, you know what song's terrible?
Baby, it's cold. I mean, like, I love that song.
Yeah.
But we were just like, it's kind of in this day and age with our new language, you know, and how, so that year was so, like, last
2016.
Year was so, a lot of things came up, like the Brock Turner case and everything. We just kind of were like, that song doesn't really fit anymore because our language has changed. So why don't we just, like, update it? It was absolutely just for fun. But then it went globally viral.
I feel like something might be happening. Something similar might be happening with the idea of the Femme Fatale with this event.
Yeah.
Because if we think about the character of the Femme Fatale, it goes right back to, like, ancient literature and the idea of the sirens who will lure the sailors to their wreck. And it's funny to, and then there's Helen of Troy, and there's Clytemnestra.
Never even heard of that gal.
Well, watch out. and then, of course, there's famously, we were talking before the interview about the Velvet Underground and Nico song. But even that, you know, the lyrics, of course, are by Lou Reed, written at the request of Andy Warhol about E. Sedgwick. So let's kind of return to to the lyrics in that song for a moment and then think, okay, so what different things has, like, Femme Fatale meant through the ages?
Yeah, cool.
And then what are we doing with that? But first, what I should highlight, this is Nastasia.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful name.
It is a very beautiful name.
Yeah.
And you are one of, I think we determined, 11 visual artists.
Yeah, there's actually
12 now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's Destiny, who is kind of coordinating all of the visual art, and then there's 11 others. And your statement is, I create to pay tribute to the old and to manifest my ideal new. I think that's going to relate interestingly to the old things that Femme Fatale has meant, and then what we're making it mean with this event. I gather what the world has given and put it right back with my dirty fingerprints all over it. So you were telling me a bit before the interview about what that means in this specific context, to do with clothes. Could you elaborate a bit?
Yeah, so I make clothes. I go to thrift stores and I find clothes that are in like not good condition that other people wouldn't necessarily choose or like pick. And I choose like bigger items with patterns that I, or with designs on them and fabrics that I enjoy, and then I like go home and I rework them and I use the fabric as if it is new fabric, and then I make clothing out of those old clothing.
Yeah.
With
your dirty fingerprints all over them.
That's like just a reference to like me feeling like I'm making it my new thing, and like fingerprints mine.
So the act of making something new, but working, collaborating with what's present and what's past to make
existing.
It new.
Yes.
What is significant about that for you when you're creating these clothes? Is there like a political statement there, or
Well, the reason why I decided to use things that already exist is because I'm really like passionate about my environmental footprint. So I decided that in order for me to make clothes and feel good about me making new clothes, I would have to like use old clothes. I felt bad about buying new fabric and like perpetuating a lot of the like sweatshop work and supporting the capitalist thing agenda.
You're sticking it to the man.
Yeah, as I like buy fabric from new corporations.
Yeah, so there's multiple ways in which you're making a kind of intervention here, and it's ethical. In terms of thinking about the environment, in terms of thinking about labor.
Yes.
And you're not the only artist involved in the event at the Cedar Cultural Center that is pointing a finger at American excess. For example, one of the others makes massive pottery to highlight this, you know, the excess of American consumerism. So that's Liz Bunce.
I think that a common theme throughout all of the artist statements is very much like paying tribute to their femme identities, but I think that what a lot of us are trying to say is like we're a lot more than that, and that like we are femmes and we are femme fatales, and we can like make good things.
Yeah. What do you feel the term femme has traditionally meant? And speaking of taking what's working with the present and then making the ideal new, what components are you trying to add to that?
What I'm trying to say with how the artists, I think, and myself are trying to like present is that we are femme fatales, and like it's a really good umbrella term that we can all like fit under. But I think that what we're trying to add, and like the way that we are reshaping that, is that like that's just like not it. Like we are our art past that, and we have a lot more to say than just traditional what you were speaking of before.
Because if taking it back to the whole femme and butch thing, that comes from a very hegemonic idea of relationships where there needs to be like someone in the traditional male role, someone in the traditional female role. On the one hand, the term inherently addresses the systematic devaluation of femininity, but on the other hand, if we think about it as in a dichotomy with butch, suggests that there needs to be a kind of like more passive or there needs to be a meek component.
Yeah.
So now it's really interesting kind of taking that and what a femme fatale has traditionally been and thinking about what's going on. Because when people comment on your performances, for example, Lydia, Andrea Swenson, but she's a good friend of yours too now, but before she met you, she said, oh, the singer of Bombadilhoz must be mesmerizing live. And Rob Callahan has said very similar things about you too. So the entrancing, mesmerizing component of the femme fatale seems to continue. But there's a lot of very negative stuff related to the idea of the femme fatale.
Mm-hmm.
Like she's like a witch, or she'll kind of...
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're performing at this event.
Yeah.
We've been talking about the femme, the idea of the femme, the idea of the femme fatale. What kind of intervention do you think you and everyone is making?
I think a lot of us are just willing to take up more space than a lot of women have been allowed in history. That's kind of what it's been to me lately, is just not being afraid to be there and present and loud and existing. You know, I just started this new job and I work with a lot of dudes.
Uh-huh.
And I realized navigating the world as a woman is very different. And I was trying, we were telling stories about our life, and I was trying to get a word in, and I was not allowed, you know?
Right.
Like, I had really funny stories for these two conversations that were going on, and I was like, yeah, my grandma. Okay, I'll just let that one go. And then there was another one where I was like, yeah, one time I actually. Okay, all right, you know. And
what,
I
missed opportunities.
Yeah, man.
For the dudes.
Yeah,
they missed their opportunities.
Pretty good story.
But we have to make sure you get some good stories in
to this
interview.
Yeah, but to me lately it's just been the powerful taking up space, man spreading. You know.
Good.
You know
that's
I mean?
Great.
Yeah.
But then that's really interesting. The quote from Rob Callahan was interestingly, her unique folk sound combines a full, rich, and crisp sounding guitar with vocal power and timbre akin to a whisper. And that's something that remains the case. So you said you want to be there and loud, but often it's you being there and quiet and yet controlling the room that is like the power of the revised femme fatale Lydia Liza. Does, I imagine it does, this being able to control the room but through quietness and through a certain type of fragility, does that remain a core component of Lydia Liza? And if so, how does that relate to your appropriation of the femme fatale? Because it's a mesmerizing female, but the manner of the mesmerizing is really distinct and important.
I think it's kind of like, you know, like, integrity and respect for oneself and just control. That would be it.
Dusty Springfield is someone who and I bring
Ooh,
up
I
Dusty
love
Springfield. I know you do
because
I was reading an interview that you did back in May 2014.
Dang, it was that long ago.
And that was when you were performing for Girl Germs in Minneapolis.
Yeah, that was fun.
And you covered some Dusty Springfield.
Yeah, the whole set.
Set of Dusty Springfield.
Yeah.
So what was the... and I made that seg because you were saying at the time in that interview that she was someone who was not afraid to sound urgent, soulful, and heartbroken. So that's interesting. The combination of urgency, like being driven, purposeful.
Yeah.
But... part of her strength is the heartbreak and the being open about the heartbreak.
Oh, she is such a good
What person. Was it like to perform those songs? Like,
it was tough.
Yeah?
Because it was a whole set of like, I'm so sad, you know? And getting into those shoes, which, you know, is funny because as soon as I got on stage, I was wearing high heels and I was like, F these, and took them off. But like, putting myself in that vulnerability, it was like, it's kind of exhausting.
How does Dusty's vulnerability relate to or differ from Lydia's vulnerability?
It's like the same thing. I mean, every album I've ever put out is just heartbreak and navigating the world.
You said back in 2014 that as much as, you know, you say you were, at the time you were saying you were going through lots of changes, but your music would change as your life changed.
Yeah.
But heartbreaks and headaches would remain.
Yeah.
Would remain in the music.
It's true. I mean, those are such a key component of life in general, you know. And I think, you know, people have been truthful about that for centuries in song, you know. Yeah.
Components of your music have remained the same.
Yeah.
But you've of course been evolving a lot, T.
Mm-hmm.
And when you had your interview back, season 2, episode 1, back on Cyanet Radio, you performed a for you uniquely short, brand new song that you had written that week, and that's called "Bring Me Some Easy."
Mm-hmm.
Is that still in your sets? Is that evolved further?
Yeah, actually, it got longer.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Remains unique, but it's but now it's longer.
Yeah. That song is just about the heartbreak of losing a very, very close friend.
Partly through choice, if I understand correctly.
Yeah.
So, how so? What kind of predicament or situation is the song grappling with?
Yeah, it was, I had a really, really close friend, like absolute soulmate, best friend, and we were both going through the wrong motions in life, you know, and we got in this really terrible fight, and it was at my boyfriend's grandma's house.
Wow.
And it was just like this super dramatic night, and we both knew in the morning we had to walk away from it, and just...
From each other, not just from that particular fight.
Exactly. It just... I invited her in for some spaghetti, and she was like, no, I'm just going to go home, and we never... spoke again.
I know there's nothing to show for how long you've been here. It brings me down every time. So you're mine. I bought all the doubt with the thought of you. It brings me down every time. I have fangs, I still got a nice smile, and I've been in a war before. I can last a while. I am a woman sculpted out of empathy, but that doesn't give you the right to fuck with me. So come by, come bring a dove to my doorstep. My white flag is torn down the middle. I've waited too long just for simple. Couldn't you bring me some easy, baby?
That song was partly me being like, I know I don't deserve what you had said to me. Like, I don't want this to be part of my identity and continue to, like, move through this knowing you said that. And everything she had said, and I also don't want to be someone you blame for everything that goes wrong in your life, so this it'd be best to, you know, bring ourselves some easy and move away from this, you know.
That sounds like a good reason to move beyond someone.
I didn't want it to be part of our identities, you know, like, because it was such a defining moment in us.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know.
And it seems like a defining moment in your songwriting. I said at the end of the episode after you performed it, Lydia Liza is a woman sculpted out of empathy, but that doesn't give you the right to fuck with her.
Yeah.
Which is the lyric. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is your lyric in your song.
Yeah.
And I think that really speaks a lot to this conversation that we're having right now. There is a strength and a power. We experience it through Dusty Springfield.
Absolutely.
We experience that power of someone who's sculpted out of empathy. Like, there's so many, like, you know, imagine those dudes who aren't letting you get a word in edgeways. And maybe they think that they're strong and they've got command of the situation or whatever.
Yeah.
But the strength of empathy is a strength that it sounds like they were completely lacking.
Yeah.
But it's a difficult balancing act, isn't it? If the strength is empathy, it needs to be balanced with, but that doesn't give you the right to fuck with me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. How does the, what are some other ways in which the but that doesn't give you the right to fuck with me, how did it come through in either of your ads?
Saying before, when you were talking about someone claiming her to be mesmerizing. Mm-hmm. I think that the ownership of being a woman and or being like a femme,
yeah,
identifying, I think that there's like a lot of seductive type aspects that like we feel that we can take control of, and
yeah,
I think that's kind of like an asset that we all have in being a woman or being a femme identifying.
Yeah,
that is exactly what I am. Like when I do make my art, is like I am trying to portray, and like I am using my female identity to seduce. But I think that like the badass feeling of all of us, or at least me feeling like, I think that the like seductive thing is an asset, and our badass feeling is very present in all of the art that we're trying to make, and we're trying to say like we're good, if not better than our counterparts.
Yeah, being a badass is primary.
Yeah.
Like being seductive is like secondary to that. It's something that happens by virtue of being a badass.
Yeah.
But it's not like the full extent of the power.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Some of those lyrics written by Lou Reed for Andy Warhol at the request of Andy Warhol about a woman that Andy Warhol didn't use very well, didn't treat very well. Here she comes, you better watch your step. She's going to break your heart in two. It's true. It's not hard to realize. Just look into her false-colored eyes.
Right, yeah.
This needs the Lydia and Josiah treatment, I think. You joked to CNN about putting out a whole record of reworked songs. I think that Femme Fatale should be on it. She builds you up just to break you down. Look out for these Femme Fatales. So it's really interesting that we end up with Nico powerfully singing it, and yet it's like these men's plan and these men's words. But maybe even in that moment, something important in terms of an intervention is happening through Nico.
She takes ownership of it.
Yeah.
You know? Which is so badass.
Yeah. I'll build you up and break you down.
I'm totally gonna fuck you up. Yeah, absolutely. You know?
Yeah.
Which is, you know, I don't think anybody should set out to fuck anybody up, but you know.
I think that's
unless it's Andy Warhol.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Kind of, but you know, I don't like
thinking about the power of being a woman sculpted out of empathy. That's kind of at odds with that. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a confused guy. I don't fucking know.
Well, don't resolve the confusion. It's wonderful. Let's think about what you're doing in relation to what some of the other musical acts are doing involved in this event.
Totally.
Because there's a wonderful cast involved. I love the poster. And in the poster, in the best kind of femme fatale roles, we have Ava from McFarlane from Ava.
Yeah.
And we have Michaela from Good Luck Finding Iris. And we have you, of course. And we have DJ Keezy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So those are the acts kind of really prominent on the poster, which we can see just here.
it's not really
flowers. it's a poster for the event. And which of those acts are you particularly excited about to be on the bill with, and why?
Oh my gosh, I'm excited to be there with everybody.
Yeah.
There's so much power exciting. In like just a bunch of women hanging out.
Yeah.
It's like, it really feels so, like the camaraderie is absolutely amazing.
As DJ Keezy exemplified with the clituation.
Yeah.
In the First
so
Avenue main room.
Because
she, Sophia Eris, B. Dot Croc, and Maria Issa were the lituation.
Oh, sick.
To begin with. That was what their project was. And they performed a few shows. And then I believe it was... Maria suggested it should be the clituation. Yeah,
so
exactly.
Good.
Yeah.
She's so good.
And I think that the way in the but that doesn't give you a right to fuck with me
component,
you know, really comes through in the badassery of that name.
Yeah.
So, but that's, DJ Keezy is the, what presented that event.
Yeah.
She's been referred to as the DJ who brings female energy center stage. So, and again, I think maybe something analogous to what you do with the clothing, where she kind of demonstrates, this is what my energy is. And so your kind of outdated ideas about what female energy might be are being blown out of the water by my female energy in effect. Were you able to make it to that, the Clituation event?
Yeah, I
couldn't either. But that had everyone from Sarah White, Lady Midnight, Vee Bohem.
They had everybody.
Yeah, they really did. And DJ Keezy is someone who... you know, she DJed at the Minneapolis Yoga Conference, for example. So, again, combining this badassery with a focus on, like, self-care and on a certain type of serenity. Again, this, because the need to be like, fuck you, it doesn't give you the right to fuck with me, and to be a badass, to some extent, you know, we could see that as emerging from this kind of hegemonic relationship where... you know, you need to kind of be the opposite. So it's really interesting how, like, this event in particular and these bands will dip into what Good Luck Finding Iris and Ava are doing with this momentarily. But I think that this event is a really interesting kind of focus point for what's going on here. You were talking about nature as being very important in your artistic process. So Good Luck Finding Iris have a lot of lyrics involving nature. Can you, are there any that come to mind for you?
Well, I know that they discuss a lot, like, the changing of seasons.
Yeah. In the song, Christopher Robin, for example, which is why Piglet gets to...
Did you really plan that much?
Yeah, lots of planning. So Christopher Robin is a favourite song of mine by Good Luck Finding Iris. Winter Days, Autumn Moons, and then later on, Winter Days turning into Spring Nights. I find it interesting, again, thinking about both nature and gender here, that we have this song called Christopher Robin, and the lyric is, Christopher Robin, where do you go? Lost in the forest, for all we know. So there's this, alongside the looking for Iris, which even the name has a lot to do with nature. We'll come to that in a moment. But we could imagine that as like a female.
Yeah.
We also have this search for Christopher too.
Yeah. keep losing everybody.
And finding themselves,
yeah.
which is what the name is about. Are you familiar with that song? The Christopher Robin song. It has the lyric "How she feels" as well, which is interesting in this song about the boy Christopher Robin. It's still the lyric is about how she feels, and I think that there is a reference to Wendy in it too.
I think that that song has underlying themes of losing innocence and youthfulness, and that's what Christopher Robin like represents.
Yeah,
and with that, I think Michaela really brings an energy with her voice where she's kind of, her voice is just pure badass. Like, it's just all, like, it just screams, like, this is me and, like, fuck you. And it's just really cool.
Yeah. It's so cool.
I think that...
It simultaneously does that whilst also kind of empathizing with Christopher Robin and doing these very different things at the same time.
If
Michaela were here, then I would ask her, what does it mean to look for Iris? And the bio provides an answer, which is, well, there's a description of the process of looking for Iris. From the misty haze of morning light, it relates to nature, emerges a sound drawn from the rivers of spring and lifted to the edge of the forest's reach. This is the place where the iris climbs upward. This is the sacred hollow, the common ground of four wanderers, those being the four members of Good Luck Finding Iris. And then this is the important thing. Ours is the voice of youth, of light, of harmony, the voice that speaks louder, crying out in search of meaning, in search of guiding melody that returns the soul to the forest. The iris is that which is in all of us.
Dang.
Growing and changing, allowing each person to embrace their beauty and to develop into that which they absolutely must. So the band itself, Good Luck Finding Iris, is all about each of us finding ways to develop and grow.
Yeah.
Like the iris. That's what the iris is. And good luck finding it. And it's real. Like
that's so awesome.
But can we think a little bit about, especially as with this event being on Earth Day, and they're obviously using very kind of earthy metaphors just there to describe this very natural process. Could you talk a little bit about your just personal search for purest self? Trying to find Iris.
I think that's another common theme of everyone's artist statement and everyone.
Yeah.
Well, the basis of art on its own and like with everyone is just trying to express yourself and trying to find yourself. And
yeah.
I think that it's especially true with all of the artists involved in this event.
My belief is just all of life is trying to find it,
yeah.
You know?
To find the self, to find one's
absolutely.
Pure true self.
Like,
yeah.
Bob Dylan touches on that so much, like, he who is not busy being born is busy dying,
mm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
that, and I have a massive belief that once curiosity is gone, life is over.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I my sister texted me the other day, she's going to school for English at the U of M, and, she read this quote that was just, art exists to remind you what life is,
mm-hmm.
you know? And mm-hmm. I think that is it. I mean, why else would we be driven to create?
Yeah.
Other than trying to describe something that is undescribable.
So that's something that, as an artist, it's a personal quest to do this, not to find Iris, to be in touch with ourselves.
Yeah.
And then there's a public quest to kind of share that and remind others.
Yeah, and I feel like, you know, within Unity, there's some people are better at translating than others are.
Yeah.
So some people experience something and they can translate it through art that really touches someone else.
Yeah.
That person didn't even know they needed to hear this, you know? Like,
yes,
it's
yeah.
so tight. I just love art. It's so cool.
But those two quests, the personal and the public quest,
yeah.
are they ever at odds? So, you know, once you are seen as an artist,
yeah.
as someone who, you know, who is expected to do this, are there moments where there are kind of demands on you as an artist that are actually impediments to feeling... to finding Iris, to being in touch with yourself.
Yeah.
Yes. And so what are some of those that you've experienced?
Well, you know, for me, it was really hard growing up in the city's public eye.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause I was like 15 when I first started.
Very much put in the spotlight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm not blaming it on anybody. It's just that was my path. And
yeah.
Through that, I started really struggling with mental health, and mm-hmm. it was a public thing then. Like,
yeah.
I,
because you're in the public eye.
Yeah, so I would, like, be posting on Facebook just, like, just whining, and I would have people, like, fans be like, you all right? You okay? And I would be like, fuck. Like, I can't navigate social media the way my friends can, and I can't, you know, and it's hard, it's a huge privilege and a gift, and I have a platform, you know, to do good, but it was really hard to navigate myself within knowing that other people were watching me navigate, you know. I still really struggle with it, and and just recently I've had another big bout of just like mental health crises, and just stepping away, I always feel guilt, you know, just being like, I really need to walk away from this for a little bit, and I don't write as much as I'd like, and you know, it's a lot, you know.
Do you, guilt about temporarily moving away from the artist role to
which I've been to secure kind of stepped away from for I'd say years now that I've kind of people know it that I haven't been like making albums or anything but you know there's a guilt and you feel like people are waiting for you but that's not often right or true.
Yeah,
everybody is just trying to figure it out for themselves. It's been hard for me to realize that people aren't looking at me because I thought people were for so long. You know what I mean?
Mm, absolutely.
Yeah. So it's hard for me to be alone with myself without feeling this like, are people wanting me? Which is super self-indulgent and fucked up and I hate it. But it's like, it's something that was just ingrained because I grew up with it and that was all I knew. Yeah, it's just weird. It's just weird. But it's like also an amazing gift and a responsibility and privilege that I'd like to live up to and I'd like to continue to be an artist, but it's hard sometimes.
Speaking about continuing with that, you were already saying that the song that we referenced that you debuted last time, Bring Me Some Easy, has evolved and it's longer now. I was asking you at the time about what you would like to do with that in terms of doing a recording, and you were saying that there were two sets of people that you enjoy working with.
Yeah.
POS on the one hand, or you were considering taking it to Eric Bloomquist.
Yeah.
And Big Cats and Eric Mason, who, you know, the team behind Detail, Eric Mason's Detail.
Yeah.
Did you decide to do either of those two things, or did you do something different? Or?
Right now I'm trying to decide if I even like the studio setting.
Yeah, right.
Because I hate the feeling of expectation.
Yeah.
So I've been practicing a lot with recording my own stuff. And
well, that worked with the Baby It's Cold Outside.
Yeah, it did. But yeah, right now I have on my lap, I have 15 covers. I just recently did a GoFundMe because my laptop got stolen. But I got a new one because of amazing people.
GoFundMe.
Yeah.
Well done, amazing people. Thank you.
Yeah. I have no words for how grateful I am, but I have a really hard time asking for help. So what I did was I wanted to make sure I gave something back. So anybody who donated like $50 got to request a cover, which I have like Schism by Tool.
You haven't done that one yet.
No, I think I'm saving that one for last because it's really hard. And then just a bunch of different styles. I have some Joni Mitchell and Bonnie Raitt and stuff.
Are there any that you were led to that you wouldn't necessarily have led yourself to, but that you found especially, you found yourself finding Iris perhaps through the process of performing this cover?
A John Denver song that I used to listen to as a kid a lot that is a big part of my family. My mom loves John Denver. So someone asked for Sunshine on My Shoulders.
Oh, nice.
Which is so beautiful.
Yeah.
And so that got me in this loophole of like, maybe I'll start doing like a cover a week of songs that I found important in childhood.
Yeah.
Because I feel like I define myself a lot by who I was as a child. You know, just in like the nostalgia of growing up.
Yeah.
And
where's Christopher Robin gone?
Yeah. The things my parents have passed down to me, I've treasured greatly. So I was thinking maybe one way I could try to find myself again is just cover all these songs that I found so important as a kid, you know?
Yeah.
Because that song really got me on this, like, I was listening to, like, the soundtrack to Man of La Mancha and stuff, and I was like, this is weird. People don't just do this on it. But I had a great time. So I was thinking, you know, that could be something that I do and find myself again because I'm so lost.
You didn't seem so. What was
Thanks,
the name? what was the name of the song again? The one that you covered with Sunshine in it?
Sunshine on My Shoulders.
That's interesting because at the time when you were covering the Dusty, speaking of covers, when you were covering Dusty Springfield, and you were saying at the time that you didn't have any happy songs, you were saying, you know, my songs are for expression, to tell my story, running through thoughts and to organize myself. And of course, that continues.
Yeah.
But you were saying as opposed to songs for people to dance around to in the sunshine. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting how you kind of integrate the, you know, the sunshine component mm-hmm. into your kind of search for yeah. yourself right now.
Absolutely.
And that kind of that's like a new feature.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about Ava.
Yes.
And in relation to these threads of the importance of nature and the search for the self. They performed at this Gamut Gallery event at the end of last year
yeah.
That was called Backyard, an immersive installation.
Was that with Taba?
I think that Taba may have been involved.
Okay.
I think so.
Yeah.
And there was a promotional video I saw for it, and there's Ethan, the bassist.
Yeah.
And it was walking around in nature. Ava and he are kind of, you know, for other parts of the video, kind of, you know, there's some stills from it just there, visual aids.
Wow.
as if by magic. And they have this song called Waiting on Ava.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, from looking for Iris to waiting on Ava. There's some really interesting lyrics in that. This desire for connection, wanting to spend a little time walking through the neighborhood. The rhythm has got me entranced in a song that can't be heard, but I hear it when I see your face. Something that keeps on coming up. The use of music as a metaphor
yeah.
To describe moments of connection.
Yeah.
It seems like, you know, we were saying that this is something, there's like a responsibility we feel
yeah.
as artists in Good Luck Finding Iris. They have this song that I love called Trovata.
Yeah.
Which is an Italian word for the clear and often sudden understanding of a complex situation or the act of inventing.
That's
and
so cool.
Yeah.
Oh my God, they're so well planned out.
They really are. And
yeah.
And I feel like, but it's true to me, like in that song and in a lot of Ava's songs, it is the music, it is the entrancing rhythm that leads to these kinds of insights as opposed to necessarily like the lyrics.
Yeah.
And do you find, I think the clearest example with Ava, there's a Radio K performance of them performing Lay Me Down.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that song?
I love that
yeah.
song.
Yeah, me too. And I love how, speaking of nature and unity, there are moments in the song where they're all lay down for me and everything. Initially, the bass line and the guitar, but then also the keys, and then that vocal
mm-hmm.
comes in.
And aren't it's they clapping?
And clapping
yeah.
too. So that's really interesting how sonically the new ideal of people maybe finding Iris simultaneously, like together.
Yeah.
Through rhythm and through
yeah.
combining in a certain way.
Yeah.
Do you relate to that? Yeah.
Or find that journey, and it's hard as an artist to
do that
so
mm-hmm.
frequently, or like have those expectations because of the journey and like what we're trying to express and what we're trying to figure out inside of ourselves. It's very personal.
Yeah.
And it feels very vulnerable, like
yeah.
putting everything out there, and that expectation to present everything publicly
yeah.
is really hard.
Yeah, I think that's why a lot of like really brilliant artists keep people at arm's length.
Mm.
And like they make up stories that somehow reflect something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Bob Dylan was like amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I love Bob, love him, and he was just so good. And Bruce Springsteen, they were really good at just kind of telling a story that kind of reflected on.
Yeah. So simultaneously hiding behind a narrative but revealing
yeah.
something through that same narrative.
It can be exhausting,
yeah.
like especially with performing, just repeating like something you wrote about that you had to write about it, but you keep playing it over and over, and then you're in that headspace. Like I think Connor Oberst does
yeah.
that
mm-hmm.
frequently,
mm-hmm.
Especially like the song Lua, where he's talking about like a heroin addiction and
mm-hmm.
stuff. It's gotta be really tough to like put yourself
yeah.
in that space over and over and over on tour.
Right.
You know, that's, I think that's why a lot of people do.
Even just
heroin and stuff, you know.
Even just putting that down in the studio in the first place, but then you're right, the repetition of that, bearing your
that headspace, you know.
Yeah,
yeah.
And that's expected of you from your audience. Radiohead being expected, especially in this country, to perform the song Creep, for example.
I think they just played that for the first
time
like last year.
Yeah, they did.
For like, it had been 8 years.
They performed
like, I don't
it.
I want to fucking do it.
They performed it in my presence. I enjoyed it.
Oh,
but,
shit.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. It wasn't just for me. But
yeah. They played it for me.
I was in the presence just a couple of days ago in this room of three very powerful young women. Danielle and Bella and Emily from who are Bruise Violet, and
those guys, they're so great.
And so we've been talking about the difficulties as artists, the kind of expectation that's put on you. Okay, do this thing for me, perform this role, and also as women, you know, there's and that. So Danielle's song, so Danielle Penn's song Nightmare, the lyrics are, I am not your dream girl. I am not your future wife. I will not complete you. I'm your nightmare come to life.
Ooh, she's so badass.
And that, I think, is, you know, really the fruit of it. So clearly, that's Danielle is someone looking for Iris.
Yeah.
Like, and aware of the things that people do, whether it's fans or like male fans, perhaps, or men more generally, that get in the way of both of the work of the artist and of the work of the individual, and their quest. The combat, that's, you know, that's a great that really epitomizes the, but that doesn't give you the right to fuck with me component again.
Yeah, I've had men particularly ask me when about music, like, and about performing, they're like, what do you wear on stage? You know? Or, like, you should wear something more revealing. So I've, like, found power in my modesty.
Yeah.
I usually don't dress up too much for shows or anything, just because, first of all, it makes me really self-conscious if I am wearing anything low-cut or short or anything.
Yeah.
But, I kind of like to be like, I don't have to do that to command a thing. You know?
Which is it really? Yeah, which is, I don't have to be la femme fatale.
Yeah.
I don't have to be what, you know, in traditional literature and culture.
A lot of women do find power in the, not necessarily sexualization, but the revealing of themselves in their body. And
stuff.
And I find power in the opposite.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It's very, it's super individual, and I love that about that, you know? Like, I don't particularly feel like I need to wear, like, a swimsuit on stage, you know? Like, and some women are like, fuck yeah, I feel the most powerful when I take control of my sexuality and my body, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's, like, it is very individualistic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, so individualistic, that's great. The line that really strikes me from the Bruise Violet song is, I will not complete you. So
I love that.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. Thanks.
I love it too. I like my personal like take on that. Like, I, when I make art or when I'm just like presenting my identity, I feel I like to take that a step further and feel like present that I like will complete you, but like I'm more than that. Like I won't complete you in a way where like I'm not what you want me to be, but like I'm so good that like
I'm gonna add to your life too, you know?
Like,
something is missing without me.
Yeah, and
that's true. Yeah.
That's kind of like what I was trying to say, that everyone is trying to like present, I think.
Yeah.
Or like not even trying to present, but like everyone has.
Yeah, yeah. Just that they have a lot to offer beyond just being a woman and
beyond the dreams, like the norms of like what the expectations are, like we are wholly what we are, and like we're fucking amazing without meeting all of the expectations that are had usually for artists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you for being who you are, for searching for Iris, for discovering yourselves.
Yeah.
And last time, Lydia, maybe was it a recent time that you were on the stage at the Cedar Cultural Center, you were both yourself and also Bob Ross.
Mm.
because it was Halloween and you were performing with Jeremy Messersmith.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was that the most recent time you were on the Cedar Cultural stage?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And you said that was one of the most fun nights that you had performing.
Yeah.
You said. Are you rearing? Are you excited to get back on that stage?
That's my favorite stage. I really love the people at the Cedar and just the whole vibe of the place.
Yeah.
I just think it's really beautiful. It's I feel at home there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. And of course, so where will your art be on display?
My art is actually going to be outside.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a garden set up, I think, and I'm going to have a 35mm slide projection on the wall outside.
Nice.
Awesome.
Yeah, I'm not exactly sure about all the space things, but yeah.
Yeah. So much is going on at the Cedar Cultural Center on Saturday, April 22nd. Not only all of the musical acts that we've been talking about today, but 12, it turns out, 12 visual artists.
Kick ass.
And DJ Keezy, of course, I can see like a connection with what you're doing. Again, back to you're taking the old clothes and making something new of them. Her signature spinning, her signature style as a DJ is to spin throwbacks, tracks by female artists, and the hottest new remixes with her dirty fingerprints all over them. So it's going
to
be a really fun night. We can simultaneously let the rhythm entrance us and affect us. Dance
unify.
The DJ Keezy, unify us. Yeah, we can find Iris together in one. But at the same time, make sure that nobody fucks with us too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Be the badasses, which is what you are first and foremost.
Yeah.
So yeah, Cedar Cultural Center on Saturday, April 22nd. Thank you very much, guys, for joining us.
Thanks for being here, Simon.
Yeah. Oh, you're very welcome. And thanks for tuning in to Back to the City. I'm Simon Calder, and we'll be at the Cedar Cultural Center on Saturday.
What's that calling me? 'Cause it keeps calling me.